Lord, we love you tonight, and we thank you for your grace and your presence and just the opportunity that we get as a unified body of believers to worship you online, virtually, worship you together. Father, we thank you that there's no distance in prayer, that collectively we can express our gratitude to you and our praise to you, and you send miracles in motion. And I just believe that tonight, that as we've worshiped you and lift your name up, that you are doing the work in our lives that we can't do, transformative work in our hearts and in our lives. And Lord, we just thank you that we're getting stronger, that we're getting better, that we're going to leave this space today together different, more like you. So thank you for healing. Thank you for supplying all of our riches according, all of our needs according to your riches and glory. And thank you, God, that you are making a way where there seems like there is no way. You're fighting our battles for us. And we thank you for victory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, thank you so much for tuning in with us tonight. I love that we can join our faith together online, and just want you to know that we consider you our extended family, and we pray for you all the time. We want you to know that. And also, I'd like to extend an invitation to you to come visit us in person here in Houston whenever it's comfortable for you. I would love to meet you. Our team would love to meet you. Just love to see you worship with us here at Lakewood whenever you can get the opportunity. Well, I want to talk to you briefly today about how to develop the leader within you. I want to speak to the leader that is in each of you watching. You see, I believe every person has been given a measure of influence, meaning each of us has the ability to lead. You see, the question today isn't if you can lead or if you are a leader. The better question today is, how are you stewarding your influence? Or what kind of leader are you? You see, we're all leading people. So it's important that we develop and we grow as leaders so that we're better for our families, we're better at work, we're better in every space that we find ourselves today. You have the potential and the opportunity to grow in your leadership and your influence right now in this season. And what most of us have realized about life and about leadership, this is very important to understand, is that you can't control life. As hard as you might try to control life today, life for the most part is uncontrollable. You may feel in control, but the reality is control is an illusion. I heard a friend once say this, life is 10% what happens to you and 90% how you respond. I'd say the same holds true for your leadership. You see, I can't always predict what's going to happen. You can't always predict what's going to happen, but I can make, and you can make, a predetermined decision on how you will respond. Response to life, response to relationships, to circumstances is essential. And I want to talk today about two responses that will define and develop the leader within you today during this season of your life. How you respond to success is one, and how you respond to failure. How you respond to success and how you respond to failure. First one, how do you respond to success? What do you do when you crush it? When you make the sale? When your department is seeing overwhelming success? You break the record, you win MVP, you crush that assignment. What do you do when you experience success? Proverbs 27:21, it says this, fire tests the purity of silver and gold, but a person is tested by being praised. In other words, success can often be a greater test of our character than a problem. Problems, pain, and conflict, the valleys, those things all test us. We know this. But a greater leadership test, I believe, according to this scripture, is praise. So how do you respond to praise? How do you respond to success? I want to look at a powerful example in the Bible, in the book of Genesis. A man named Abram faces a major dilemma here. His family has been taken by the Mesopotamian army. This is a dominant army that no one could stop in this text. They were a powerful force and they're in complete control of the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. It seemed in the natural that there's no hope for Abram. How could he stand any chance of rescuing Lot from such a powerful enemy? I mean, it just seems impossible. However, what's so cool about this story is in the face of uncertainty and what looked like a guaranteed defeat, in Genesis 14, Abram gathers and prepares to lead some 300 men against this massive army. They're clear underdogs. They catch up to the enemy army just north of the Sea of Galilee, and surprisingly, against all odds, they were able to defeat the opposition and run them out of Canaan. They rescued the people and the possessions out of Sodom and Gomorrah, along with Abraham's nephew Lot and his family. Friends, this was a huge military victory that gained Abram recognition throughout the land of Canaan. No other king could defeat the army that he just defeated. And he did it with only 300 men. Imagine, Abram is on every headline. He's on every Instagram post. He goes from being unknown underdog to having the status of the dominant military leader in that area. This is no doubt a huge success for Abram and for his leadership. But what I want us to see here, I want us to see how he responds to this tremendous success and newfound fame and influence. The king of Sodom, the priest King Melchizedek, were two leaders that he rescues. So when the priest King Melchizedek came out to meet him, Abram does something odd. The Bible says that Abram gives him a tenth of everything that he now possessed as an offering to the Lord. When the king of Sodom, you know, interrupts him and tries to stop him and tell him to keep the possessions for himself, Abram refused. He believed they weren't his to keep. He believed that the victory and the success and the wealth and the possessions that had all belonged to the Lord. Abram, in the middle of his success, gives glory and honor to God and wouldn't take credit for himself. His responses here reveal that when it came to his tremendous success and victory over the enemy army, he didn't believe that the victory came from his attack strategy or the strength and the skill of his men. He believed that ultimately it was God, the possessor of heaven and earth, who delivered his enemies into his hands. That the success and the victory belonged to God and not him. You see, I believe that this is a powerful reminder for all of us. That as we steward our influence and what to do when we experience any type of success, whether it's a big sale or it's a win or it's massive growth, that we would pause, that we would take a moment, whether it's public or it's not, and that we would honor God and that we would give Him the glory. Reminding yourself, reminding your team, and reminding your family, your coworkers, that your success is a direct result of God's favor, provision, and goodness. The reality is that temptation comes to all of us to slowly begin to think that our success is from our hard work, our strategy, our creativity. Friends, those are necessary in the equation of success, but they are not the ultimate cause of your successes. You know, it's good to read stories like Abram. It's good to remember, like Abram did here, when it's obvious or when it's not, when it's a small success or it's a large, miraculous one, to give God glory. May I suggest a response to the leader within you, a response for you, for your team, for your business, wherever you find yourself. It's a mantra of sorts, a reminder every time you experience success. Here it is. God gets the glory. The team gets the credit. And I am honored to be a part. I'll say that again. God gets the glory, the team gets the credit, and I am simply honored to get to be a part of what God's doing. You see, most influential leaders who experience any type of success over a long period of time, they responded to success in a similar way. Deferring to others, giving God glory. You see, this consistently, this pattern, this response to success, it consistently keeps our hearts in the right place and posture so that we can continue to grow as leaders, continue to be trusted with more influence, more opportunities, and greater impact. So that's the first response today that is critical. The second response that I believe is critical to our growth as leaders. Are you ready for this? So one is our response to success, but the second response is just as important, and it's our response to disappointment. Our response to the door not opening, but the door shutting. When you don't get the opportunity you hope for. When you didn't make the cut, when your idea or your presentation didn't get accepted. The Bible says in Proverbs 24:16 that the righteous man falls 7 times, but he gets back up. Notice that this verse is talking about a righteous person. This is a person who's chasing their purpose. That person will fail, that they will hit obstacles, that they will hit some closed doors, but here the Bible says they continuously get back up. How you respond to disappointment directly impacts your growth as a leader. Another biblical example for this response is found in 1 Chronicles chapter 17. David is the man in this chapter. He's on the mountaintop in this season of his life. He's settling in one night after celebrating a major success on the battlefield. He's chilling on his couch. He's relaxing. He's scrolling through Netflix. And he realizes as he's in this comfortable home, as he's in this palace, that the Ark of God is in a tent. So he's experiencing all this momentum, all this success. The company is booming. He's experiencing growth, but he realizes that the Ark of God, the presence of God is being housed in a tent. This bothers him. He can't sleep. And as he's pondering this, he gets a great idea, an idea to build a new home for the Ark. So he rushes to the prophet Nathan and he tells Nathan about his big idea. Nathan then goes and he consults with God about the plan, but God says no. I mean, can you imagine this if you're David? He presents this idea. I mean, imagine how he must feel. He's led for God, okay? And he's experiencing a massive amount of success and favor. He's at the peak of his momentum. The company is growing. And this is an awesome idea that is necessary for the Ark of God. But David receives a no. He receives a rejection, a closed door, you could say. David is, like any of us, he's obviously disappointed, as we all would be. But how does he respond to the no? What's David's response to this? The Bible says that he goes in and he sits before the Lord in God's presence. And he says to God, "Who am I? Who am I that you have treated me so kindly? I don't deserve anything that I have. You found me, God. You favored me. I don't understand the no, but God, not my will, but your will be done." This is a powerful, powerful response. In humility, David finds the courage to pray. Not just to pray, but to pray for the right perspective of the disappointment. You see, he fought to sit before God and trust him in this moment. He asks why, he vents, but he sits and he trusts. See, David had the ability, the resources, the manpower, but for whatever reason, this wasn't in the cards for David in this season of his life. So how do you respond today in this season when your idea doesn't get used? When you don't get the role that you hope for? You didn't get the piece of property. The door you thought was going to open closes. I want you to see what David does and what happens with David's no, the end of the story in Chronicles, because I think it's powerful for us to understand, and I think it'll influence your response. God would speak to the prophet, and the Bible says that God selects Solomon to be the one to build the ark's new home. He chooses someone else. Friends, do you know who Solomon was? Solomon was David's son. He was David's son. So God did not say no to David's plan. He said no to David executing the plan. It was a no to David in one sense, but a big yes to his legacy. I mean, as a father, any dad would take this any day. His son carrying out his plan, carrying out his idea, carrying out his legacy. So what do we learn here about this powerful ending? Even when God says no, it's a setup for a better yes. Friends, God always has better in store for you. Trust God for your future. Let this realization influence how you respond to disappointment. When you're faced with a no, when you're faced with a closed door, respond like David, because you believe in faith that God not only has your best in mind, but it's a setup for a better yes. So today, fight to sit with God. Ask the whys, vent. God already knows your frustration with the disappointment. It's okay to be honest and frustrated, but don't stay there. Trust God. Know, like David found out, that God is working out his best plan for your life. His ways are higher than our ways. So trust his character and his goodness in the face of your disappointment. There's always a good reason God allows something in your life, and always something good that he's working out of every circumstance. So as we close our thought, we see that in both responses to both our success and our disappointments, both responses are the same. They are predetermined choices to come to God and sit. To come to God as a leader and sit before him. I heard a friend recently tell me that he wants to end every day palms up. He wants to end every day palms up. That as a leader that has a lot of responsibilities, he wants to end every day palms up. And his definition of that is, no matter if business and life that day brought a lot of failures or a lot of successes, he is going to choose to surrender it all to God. Palms up. I'm going to rest. I'm going to trust God. I like that idea. I challenge you with that concept and that mindset, that you would end every day palms up, whether you're on the mountaintop or the valley, whether the door opened or the door closed. Let's be believers who live our lives palms up. You know why this is important? Because when we live this way, it keeps our identity and our self-worth from being solely wrapped up in what we produce or what we do. Or better yet, what we don't produce or what we don't get done. See, success or failure at work, in school, in athletics, it shouldn't and it doesn't change your self-worth. Success and failure are a part of life, but those things never change the fact that you are loved, that you are chosen, that you are redeemed, and that you are favored. You see, these two key responses, they help us from attaching who we are to what we do. Those always must be separated consistently. And God's designed you, friend, to be confident in him, to be secure in him, to be fully aware of who you are as a child of God, walking into your world and your space of influence, walking into your career, knowing that you're approved. You're not looking for approval. You're not looking for sales to go up to feel good about yourself. You already know who you are. Success or failure does not dictate your self-worth. And I believe that great leaders are people who are great. That they are great. Not just people who do great things, but people who are great. People who live with a keen sense of their worth and value. They're secure leaders, and they're free to compliment and to serve other people. They're secure people who are free to love without strings attached, looking to push others forward, knowing that God has got their back. Do you see why how you respond is important and critical to your destiny? I want you to know today that I'm believing and declaring over your life that as you predetermine your response to your successes and your failures to sit before God, honoring Him, palms up, submitting to His plan, I'm declaring that you will continue to discover your self-worth and identity as a leader in Him and in Him alone, coming back to that place of humility, just grateful that He chose you and that He has great things in store for you. And I declare you will see your leadership grow to new levels, and the impact you have in other people and those around you will be greater than you ever imagined. In Jesus' name, if you believe that over your life during this season, just receive it. Say amen in the comments. I pray that you receive that today, that it encourages you, and that it'll continue to help develop the leader that is within you. And I want you to just right now, just take a minute and share this with someone that you think needs to hear it. Maybe there's someone in your world right now. Maybe it's a coworker that you know just experienced some of these things that we talked about today. Just share it with someone that you believe it will encourage and inspire today. Well, before we wrap up, we don't like to close any moment that we get together without giving people the opportunity to make Jesus the Lord of their life. So right where you're at right now, I want you to simply repeat this simple prayer of faith after me. Jesus, the greatest leader of all time, wants a relationship with you, and He wants to begin to unlock the greatness that is on the inside of you. You see, Jesus and following Him is the beginning of becoming the best version of yourself. You're not actually losing yourself. You're actually becoming the best version of yourself, the best husband, the best son, the best leader. So repeat this simple prayer of faith after me if you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life. Right where you're at, say, Jesus, I come before you today and I surrender all that I am. I ask you to forgive me of all my mistakes and all of my sins. Come into my life, wash me clean. I make you my Lord and my Savior in Jesus' name, amen. Friends, if you prayed that prayer, I want to congratulate you on your new beginning. Check out our website, check out other things that we have here on our YouTube channel where we can just continue to be a resource of hope and encouragement to you, especially in this next season of your life. Well, I don't want to close out without giving you a blessing. From Numbers chapter 6, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. And the Lord turn His face toward you and give you His peace. We love you. God bless you. And we'll see you soon.